My name is Pastor Marlon Curtin. This is the Rockway Cathedral. Welcome to our Sunday service. Welcome to our Sunday service. If you like what you see here, please don't forget to like, share, and subscribe. Please don't forget to like, share, and subscribe. Our foundational scripture is Matthew 7, verses 24 and 25. Matthew 7, verses 24 and 25. We at the Rockway Cathedral say, we're building God's kingdom in you. Be blessed.
It's October 2nd, 2022. Welcome to online worship at the Rockaway Cathedral. We are so glad that you have chosen to be with us this morning. Whether you're just having a look or seeking a place to worship, we are delighted to have you here. And though we may not be able to meet together physically, that is not going to stop us from rallying together spiritually. Join us online for a time of worship and a message from Pastor Marlon Curtin.
Join us in experiencing the joy of singing to the Lord with the gospel duo, Melody and Harmony.
Bible study is back starting September 13th. Join us on Tuesdays for our series, Loving God, Loving Your Neighbor, and Loving Yourself. Meet with us every Tuesday from 7:30 p.m. to 8:30 p.m. on Zoom, meeting ID 960-2462-6792 and password 271927. We hope to see you there. COVID is still here, and we want you to remember to continue to follow safety protocols wherever you go. To stay up to date with the most current information, be sure to visit the CDC website regularly at www.cdc.gov.
Let's pray. Lord, we thank you. We thank you, Lord, for your goodness. We thank you, Lord, for your mercy. Lord, your word says that he who hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. He who hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. Lord, we know that you are always speaking to the churches. Lord, we know that you are always speaking to us on some level, whether it's through your word or through revelation, through that small, still voice. Let us focus in. Let us tune in on what you're saying, not necessarily what everyone is saying. Not everybody that comes into our lives has bad advice. Not everybody that comes into our life has good advice. But you always have our best interests at heart. Let us help. Let us tune in. Help us to tune in. Help us to focus on your words for us, your guidance for us, your direction for us. Because all that leads to your will for us and your power for us and your ability to help us overcome the hurdles of life. Let us tune in. Help us to tune into your voice. Help us to tune into your word. And those things that people, either inside or outside the body of Christ, give us the wisdom to accept the positive, no matter what the source, and to reject the negative. Give us the wisdom to accept the positive, whether the advice is from people in the body of Christ or outside of the body of Christ, but also reject the negative, because that negative can come from people both inside and outside the body of Christ. Give us wisdom and give us a heart to hear. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Today's scripture of the day is taken from John chapter 13, verses 4 through 15, in the Christian Standard Bible Version. So he got up from supper, laid aside his outer clothing, took a towel, and tied it around himself. Next, he poured water into a basin and began to wash his disciples' feet and to dry them with the towel tied around him. He came to Simon Peter, who asked him, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" Jesus answered him, "What I'm doing, you don't realize now, but afterward, you will understand." "You will never wash my feet," Peter said. Jesus replied, "If I don't wash you, you have no part with me." Simon Peter said to him, "Lord, not only my feet, but also my hands and my head." "One who has bathed," Jesus told him, "doesn't need to wash anything except his feet, but he is completely clean. You are clean, but not all of you." For he knew who would betray him. This is why he said, "Not all of you are clean." When Jesus had washed their feet and put on his outer clothing, he reclined again and said to them, "Do you know what I have done for you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are speaking rightly, since that is what I am. So if I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have given you an example, that you also should do as I have done for you." The Rockaway Cathedral is a nonprofit organization that is seeking to win souls for the Lord in the Far Rockaway community. We especially want to make a difference in the lives of those who are often disenfranchised. However, we need your support to get there. Your act of kindness can be a lifesaver for someone. Remember, richness is not necessary, but willingness is. Please visit our website at www.therockawaycathedral.com. Click on the blue Donate tab at the bottom of the page, then click Make a Donation. We thank you for both your partnership and support. We are also asking that you continue to support us by viewing our service once a week. We're now on Cash App. You can send your donations to hashtag Rockaway Cathedral. We thank you for your partnership and continued support.
Good morning. God bless you. Welcome to the Rockaway Cathedral. My name is Pastor Maul. And today is part three of our four-part series called Heroes. So today's message is called The Visitation. And, you know, so we have the angel that visits Mary, and we have in the Iliad, you'll hear about who visits whom. So everyone gets advice from people. Everyone gets guidance from people, no matter who you are, how old you are. Somebody always wants to give you advice. Somebody always wants to give you some information. Somebody always wants to give you their opinion about where you should go, what you should do, things like that. So, you know, take it all in. Take it all in. Because the main thing is, if you live and walk in faith, you'll be able to kind of figure out what's good, what's not good, what's helpful, what's not helpful. Mary, fortunately, lived in faith. And because she lived in faith, she was able to take the information given to her and apply it in a positive direction. So, you know, you can't live your life with your hands stuffed up over your ears. You're going to hear things. People are going to say things to you. You can't tell people not to say anything to you. But the main thing, body of Christ, is to make sure that you walk in faith. Because if you walk in faith, you'll be able to use and translate that information into something that's helpful. And if it's not helpful, you'll just kindly keep walking. Kindly keep walking. The Visitation. This series is called Heroes. Be blessed.
Join us as we welcome the gospel duo Melody and Harmony.
just rest assured. Time will be no more. He is coming soon.
Good morning, God bless you. Today's message is called The Visitation. Today's message is called The Visitation. The scripture could be found in Luke chapter 1, verses 26 to 38. Luke chapter 1, verses 26 to 38. I'm going to be reading from the King James Version of the Bible. Please stand for the reading of God's holy word. Today's message is called The Visitation. The series is called Heroes, Luke chapter 1, verses 26 to 38. Here begin the reading of God's holy word. And in the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God unto the city of Galilee, named Nazareth, to a virgin espoused to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David, and the virgin's name was Mary. And the angel came in unto her and said, Hail, thou art highly favored, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women. And when she saw him, she was troubled at his saying, and cast in her mind what manner of salutation this should be. And the angel said unto her, Fear not, Mary, for thou hast found favor with God. And behold, thou shalt conceive in thy womb and bring forth a son, and shall call his name Jesus. He shall be great, he shall be called the Son of the Highest, and the Lord God shall give unto him the throne of his father David, and he shall reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there shall be no end. And Mary said unto the angel, How shall this be, seeing I know not a man? And the angel answered and said unto her, The Holy Ghost shall come upon thee, and the power of the Highest shall overshadow thee. Therefore also that holy thing which shall be born of thee shall be called the Son of God. And behold, thy cousin Elizabeth, she hath also conceived a son in her old age, and this is the sixth month with her, who was called barren. For with God nothing shall be impossible. And Mary said, Behold, the handmaid of the Lord, be it unto me according to thy word. And the angel departed from her. So far, the scripture. Lord, speak to your servant today and bless your people. In Jesus' name, amen. So we're going to be talking about two people today. One is Mary, the mother of God, the Virgin Mary. And the other is a woman called Helen of Troy. Who's Helen of Troy? Now, you know, we've been talking about the book called the Iliad. I'm not going to go through the details I went through the last 2 weeks. If you need to know the details of the book, of course, you can go through our last two sermons. Of course, you can read the book yourself, but I'm going to make it very simple for you today. So there's two sides, the Greeks and the Trojans. Trojans have one king. The Greeks have a number of kings. They have a coalition of kings. They don't have one king of Greece, but they have one king who's sort of like the coalition king. If he wants to go to war, they go to war. If they are attacked, he's the one that stands up for the country. So the coalition of kings, Greeks, and the one king of the Trojans. So one day the coalition king had a banquet and invited the sons of the king of Troy to the banquet. So he sent his two sons, older son, responsible guy, military guy, married guy, younger son, playboy, right? Older son, responsible guy, heir to the throne, younger son, playboy. They go to the banquet, they go to the feast. Of course, these things last days and days and days. They leave. When they get back, it turns out the younger son had run off with the wife of one of the kings of Greece. Run off with the wife of Renick. Her name was Helen. Her husband thought that she was kidnapped. Turns out she was not kidnapped. She went willingly with this young man. Again, he's a young man, handsome man, loves women. And he loves nothing more than to be with women. Helen was the most beautiful woman of her time. And she runs off with this man. So after that, the man's husband goes to the coalition king and says, hey, let's go to war to get my wife back. And that's exactly what happened. So you might want to ask yourself, well, why didn't the Trojans do something different? Why did they let them come all the way over there and start this war? Why didn't they just give her back? Well, very simple answer. Remember I said the older son went, the smart guy, the responsible guy, the warrior. He knows that the coalition king only wants one thing in life, and that's to beat his country. Nobody's ever beaten Troy. Troy's never been defeated in war. But because he's a coalition king, he can't fight wars by himself. He's too weak. He needs everybody. And he has no reason to go fight Troy. After Helen goes with his brother to Troy, this gives him the reason. So the oldest son says, look, there's no way if we give her back, it's going to stop anything, because all he wants to do is fight us, and now he has a reason. So his advice to his dad was, Dad, prepare for war. The Iliad written by Homer, and also the Odyssey written by Homer. Excellent books. Don't look at the movies, just read the book. Let's go through the scriptures again. The book is Luke chapter 1, verses 26 to 38. Luke chapter 1, verses 26 to 38. I'm just going to read the last three verses. And behold, thy cousin Elizabeth, and she hath also conceived a son in her old age. And this is the sixth month with her who was called barren. For with God nothing shall be impossible. And Mary said, behold, the handmaid of the Lord, be it unto me according to thy word. And the angel departed from her. I have 3 points today. First point is, who is speaking to me? Point one is, who is speaking to me? So the thing about, there's a lot of similarities between Helen and Mary, but they're not exactly the same in life. The series is called Heroes. Mary, the Virgin Mary, became a hero because she bore Jesus, the Son of God. And then she, in her own right, became a disciple of the Son of God. So she bore the Son of God, the mother of Jesus, the mother of the Messiah. That was her. So that made her famous. Her name, of course, will live forever. But some people forget. They don't realize that not only did she do that, she became an actual disciple of Christ. She was in the room. She discovered the empty tomb. She was in the room on the day of Pentecost. So she not only bore Jesus, but she became a disciple of Christ, committed her ways, committed her life to the teachings and the life of her own son. Jesus Christ. So she became a hero, but she didn't start out as a hero. She was a unknown virgin teenager living in the Middle East. An unknown virgin teenager. But for the angel's visitation, nobody would ever know who she was. She and her husband-to-be, Joseph, were in the census. The Romans had just started getting a census, but for the census, nobody would even know who she was. And guess what? If the angel had never interrupted her life, had never spoken into her life, nobody would know who she was. But now, Mary started out an unknown virgin and is now a hero. Helen is different. Helen was from a prominent family. She was a prominent person from a prominent family. She married a king, Menelaus, one of the kings in the coalition. Her sister married a king, Agamemnon, the coalition king, the head of the coalition. So she herself was from a prominent family. She married into a prominent family. Agamemnon, her brother-in-law, and her husband, they were brothers. So two sisters married two brothers. They were from a prominent household, obviously, because they were kings in their own land. And the added thing about Helen was known to be, this is all in the Iliad, and some of it is in the Odyssey. Helen is known to be the most beautiful woman of her time. Her beauty is known all throughout that part of the world. She was known to be the most beautiful woman at the time. So Helen is not a nobody. Helen is somebody who was a known quantity, a household name. You would have to go a long way to not know who Helen is. But the thing is, they were both spoken to. They were both spoken to by prominent people. Mary the Virgin was spoken to by an angel of God. Helen was spoken to by the prince, the son of the king, the son of the king of Troy. That's a prominent man. His name was Paris. So they were both spoken to by prominent people, but the advice that one gave was different than the advice that another person gave. So body of Christ, whether you are somebody like Helen, somebody who, prominent family, married into a prominent family, you yourself have some qualities that make you outstanding. You could be the smartest person in your company, right? The richest person in your company. And, you know, sometimes maybe the most beautiful person in your company. But whatever it is that makes you stand out, that makes your name out there, makes your name great, be careful who you talk to. Be careful who you listen to. Be careful who you listen to, even if the person is prominent, like Paris, even if the person is the son of the king. It's important to listen to what the person says. Because Helen is the kind of person that doesn't even deal with probably people who are considered to be commoners unless they're servants. She tells people like that what to do. But in terms of having a conversation, she only has conversations, I'm sure, with prominent people, the wives of generals and the wives of kings and the wives of wealthy landowners and the wives of the priests and the men as well. So she is used to speaking to prominent people. So her speaking to Paris is no big deal. They're at the banquet, no big deal. But be careful who you listen to, even if the person is prominent. Be careful who you listen to, even if the person is prominent. Who's speaking to me? Who's speaking to me? Be careful who you listen to. Part two, faith or fascination. They had completely different reactions to the same thing. Paris was trying to basically end her marriage to her husband. He said, you know, he was trying to convince her. Because this is what he does. This is the kind of guy he is. He's been doing this almost his whole life. So for him, Helen is just another challenge. It turns out he actually loves her. Yeah, that's one of the things that comes out in the Iliad and later the Odyssey. It's, you know, so he, for him, yeah, he's a playboy, but he feels he's in love. But, you know, he falls in love with somebody else's wife. But on her side, and we'll talk about men in those situations at a later date. But from her perspective, what he's saying to him could have a negative impact on her marriage. So it's the kind of thing where you have a very, very quick reaction. What? So somebody that you're not married to, somebody who's prominent, somebody who has a lot of money, somebody who's handsome, somebody who everybody knows is a playboy, somebody knows is wealthy, handsome, a playboy, makes a play for you. And these things happen in a millisecond, right? Either you think that this thing is fascinating, I'm fascinated by this, or you're really turned off by it and offended by it. It's a very, 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 very quick decision. These things happen immediately. You go to a dinner party, here you are, Helen, you're a prominent person. You're married to a prominent person. You're the smartest person in your company. And yes, you are a beautiful woman. And here's this person, and he openly propositions you. Obviously, your husband's not there. Openly propositions you at the banquet. Is it fascinating to you like it was to Helen? If that kind of thing is fascinating to you, the thing that could end your marriage, you could end up running away with this person. Mary, on the other hand, had the same dilemma. She was told about getting pregnant by somebody other than a husband. Obviously, this could have an immediate impact on her future. Not only does it touch on her chastity, she mentioned the fact that she was a virgin. It's like the first thing I ever, how can I get pregnant if I'm a virgin? So the very first thing that happened to her, she fell back, not on fascination, but she fell back on her faith. I spent all this time being virtuous. I spent all this time doing the right thing. You want to end it now? How could that be? One of the first reactions of Mary was, this is going to impact my view of myself. This is going to impact my personal morality. Forget about what you think, what everybody else thinks. I decided to have this particular personal morality in my life. And what you're telling me, prominent person, what you're telling me, angel of God, is I'm about to lose my virginity to somebody that's not my husband. How can this be? How is that going to happen? You're asking me to risk my future, and you're asking me to dump on my past. Her reaction to the prominent person giving her this news was not fascination. She acted in faith. She acted to guard her chastity. She acted to guard the sanctity of her marriage. And woman of God, this message is for a woman of God who is great, who aspires to be great, or you know, if you do certain things, if you listen to the word of God, the revelation of God in your life, you could be great. This message is to women who are great, who aspire to be great, or who, if they follow the path that God has given them, could be great. That's what Helen was. She was already a great person. Mary was on a pathway to greatness if she followed the directions of God. These people were the same in the same category. They didn't start out in the same category, but the interruption of God in Mary's life led her on a pathway toward greatness. Helen was already there because of her past, her marriage, and her beauty. But the reaction that you have, Mary, the reaction that you have, Helen, is based on whether or not that conversation fascinates you or horrifies you because you're concerned about your own personal morality. This is not something, you're not even thinking about your husband necessarily. This is not something that I want to do for myself. This is not something that I'm interested in doing at all. This is not how I was raised. This is not what I talk about with my friends. I don't talk about having an affair with my friends. I don't talk about stepping out on my husband with my family. That's not how I was raised. That's not what my current personal morality is, even if I was raised in a different way. Not where I am now, Barry is saying, where I am now is my own personal morality does not allow me to consider such things. And, oh, by the way, it could have a detrimental impact on my Joseph, my husband, my partner, my relationship to be. Helen, on the other hand, was intrigued by it. Just wanted to, oh, wait. Probably started thinking about, well, how is that going to work? What should I do? Probably said, don't worry about it. Just leave that to me. And eventually she ran off with Paris back to Troy. And the thing is, their choices, their decisions defined how they're viewed in history. A war was started over Helen because she chose to go with this seducer, this playboy, who claimed to be in love with her. Eventually it turns out, yeah, he was in love with her, but it wasn't her husband. So Helen is not known as Helen of Sparta, which is, her husband was king of Sparta. Helen is known as Helen of Troy. She's known by the mistake that she made. She's known by the choice that she made to run off to Troy. She's known by the choice that she made that ultimately led to the war. Mary, on the other hand, is known for walking in faith. She followed the directive of God, and she's known as the Virgin Mary. Anybody in the world, if you say Mary, 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 okay. But if you say the Virgin Mary, everybody knows who that is. Mary, the Virgin Mary, is a hero because her name will live forever. Her name will live forever because she's known by the choice that she made at that time. She's known by walking in faith. Once she understood that she would still remain a virgin, she was still a virgin after she had the child. She was still a virgin. She was, it's a long theological subject. Not going to get into that right now, but she remained a virgin. She guarded her chastity. She guarded the sanctity of her marriage. The angel later on spoke to the husband to keep him in, keep him informed, keep him in the situation. She is known by the choice she made. She's known as the Virgin Mary. Helen is known as Helen of Troy. By saying Helen of Troy, she's the woman who stepped out on her husband, and that defined her. That defined her, just like Mary's choice to follow the angel of God defined him. She's known as the Virgin Mary. These choices, these decisions, woman who's great, woman who aspires to be great, woman who will be great if you follow the path of God has in your life. These things can follow you. Be careful not of who you listen to, because people are going to speak to you, but be careful of the advice that you take. Don't be fascinated by something that could destroy your marriage. Point three, let's go. Let's go is really defined by who you go with. Who do you take with you? Are you taking your fascination with you and you end up in Troy? Or are you taking your faith with you, listening to the word of God? You end up a disciple, a mother of the Son of God and a disciple of Christ. Where you go determines what happens to you. We know what happens to Mary. She has the child. And she gets prophecy after prophecy, prophecy about her child, the Son of God, Jesus, the Son of God. Some things surprise her, some things she knows, but it's always a like this joyful surprise. Oh, wow, wow, wow. Mary understood probably before anyone who her son really was. It was reinforced from Gabriel all the way down to Anna and to the prophets, all these prophets and these angels. And the shepherds, they all reaffirmed what was told to her, that this child is special. This child will be king. This child will be the ruler. Now, that's later on. The ruler of the world, sitting on the throne of his father, David. It really defined her life. The fact that she decided to walk in faith defined her life. And Helen's life is the same thing. We know that the Greeks won over. They had the war over Helen because the Trojans couldn't give her back because it didn't make a difference. It didn't make a difference because the coalition king, all he wanted All he thought about all day was another victory. And going after Troy was his thing. So they had to have this war. And it was, you know, technically it was over. It wasn't necessarily over her, but everything was done in the name of Helen, in the name of reclaiming the honor of our country by capturing and getting Helen back from the Trojans. But, you know, there's always good news. Even if you are Helen, prominent woman that aspires to be great, women that if they follow certain things will be great, and you made that mistake, you were fascinated by the wrong man, you were fascinated by somebody outside of the marriage, you were fascinated by, you could have been a single person and made out with a married man, so maybe you did make that mistake, maybe you did violate your personal morality by being fascinated by this man at this dinner party. Maybe you did do something that was opposite to the way that you were raised, but unlike the way society can judge you, the truth is, certainly in the New Testament context, the Lord God can cancel your past. Remember, there's a woman, the woman who was caught in the act of adultery, brought by these people to Jesus, and said, "This woman deserves to be stoned. The law says she deserves to be stoned. What do you say?" And he says, well, after a while, he's drawing on the floor. He gets up and says, "You who are without sin, you cast the first stone." They thought about it for a while. They all dropped their stones and walked away, because everybody has sinned. Everybody has fallen short of the glory of God. And then he turns to her and says, "Woman, has no one condemned thee?" She says, "No, they all left." He said, "Neither do I condemn thee. Go and sin no more." Jesus interrupted that woman's future. Jesus interrupted that, the mistake that she made, the violation of her personal morality, the living in a way that's inconsistent with the way she was raised, that mistake didn't define her for the rest of your life. We can all go to Jesus for the forgiveness of our sins, and he will forgive us of sin, no matter what the sin is. If you stepped out on your marriage, or if you broke up somebody else's marriage, that doesn't have to define the rest of your life, no matter how bad it looked, no matter who said what about it, no matter what emotional pain you had to pay, sometimes a financial cost you had to pay. Maybe some other friends were lost because of this. But God does not define you by your mistakes. In his eyes, you will never be known as Helen of Troy. You will just be known as Helen, forgiven of her sins. Helen, woman of God, because she's now repented and she's rededicated her life to Christ. Your life is not defined by the mistakes you make, no matter how bad the mistakes are. We have a Savior. We have someone that's an intermediary for us. We have someone that goes to bat for us when people try to condemn it. God goes to bat for you in the spirit. God himself goes to bat for you in the spirit. The enemy wants to destroy your reputation because of this thing that you did, and wants to brand you Helen of Troy, but Jesus wants to forgive you and give you another chance. He said, "If I be lifted up, I will draw all men and women unto me." If I be lifted up on the cross, he will draw all men unto him. Jesus is calling you now. Jesus is calling you now. If that's you, if you've done this thing and people want to define you by this thing, you may have even had a child with this person. Maybe even had a child with this person, but even if that's the case, it does not define you in the eyes of Christ. It does not define you in the eyes of Christ. Come to him for forgiveness of sins. Come to him in repentance, and he will not judge you, and he can give you a new start in the spirit. Helen, you can continue to be great. Helen, not only will you be great, you will be a hero because you have now become a servant leader. Gone are the days where your leadership and your fame is based on your beauty and your family connections and your wealth and your promise. Your history, your greatness now is because you are, in fact, a servant of the Most High God. A submitted, committed, empowered servant of the Most High God. That's you, praise prayer after me. Lord, forgive me my sins. I know that you came for me. I know that you died for me. And I know on the third day you rose from the dead. Today, I confess that you are Lord, or I rededicate myself to you as my Lord. I know that you, and I declare that you rose again from the dead. Therefore, today, I'm saved, or today I'm rededicated to you as my Lord and Savior. Amen. By the way, in the books, Iliad and Odyssey, after the war, Helen is reconciled with her husband Menelaus. They work it out. Right? War's over, the Greeks win the war. She doesn't die with her lover, she goes back to her husband. And they work it out, live happily ever after. It's possible to work things out. It's possible to live a life not defined by your mistake. Jesus offers you an opportunity for a new chance, a new opportunity, a new life, a life free of the past, free of any mistakes. My name is Marlon Curtin. This is the Rockwood Cathedral, building God's kingdom in you, going victory, going peace. In Jesus' name, amen.
Father, when we think of you choosing a young virgin girl to be the earthly mother of your beloved son, we stand in awe of your great love for us. What must Mary have thought of a heavenly assignment that seemed almost unbelievable? She questioned the heavenly messenger at first, but thank God she believed and accepted the assignment. Through this act of personal sacrifice, our Lord and Savior was born in a manger on earth. He lived on earth, performed his ministerial duties, died on the cross, and rose again on the third day. We can now be called your children when we confess our sins and accept him as our Lord and Savior. We can look forward to spending eternity with you. Lord, we may never be given a divine assignment that could compare to the one that you gave Mary, but we pray that we will also say yes, Lord, to whatever you ask of us. Forgive us for the times that we have doubted your word and help us to stand firmly on your promises. We want to be faithful to you. Help us to remember that you are the one and only God, one who will always make a way for us in whatever situation you place us in. Use us in whatever way you desire. Give us the strength to comply and to share the wonders of your saving grace with those we come in contact with. We thank and praise you for your unfailing love. Amen.
Thanks for worshiping with us today. We pray that you were blessed by the word brought to us by Pastor Marlon.
Go in God's grace until we meet again for Sunday service, Tuesdays for Bible study from 7:30 to 8:30 p.m.
And be sure to check out our website for further information about our ministry. God bless you. And remember, you are dismissed from this service, but never dismissed from God's presence.